Yea, 7, he that soweth discord among brethren. He that soweth discord among brethren. Ephesians chapter 4, if you go there, is a portion of scripture, is a chapter almost entirely that's all about unity. Discord is a disagreement. It's a dispute, or it's an opposition. Quite often, discord isn't just the subtle disagreements, which are more than welcome within a body, because we're all individuals, we're all different in many different ways and have different backgrounds, but it leans more towards the disputing or the opposition side, whereby discord is a more intense disagreement, one that has feelings and emotions behind it that are quite negative. The opposite of discord would be accord. And we've heard many times that the church is to be of one accord. And so discord would be the opposite of that. Truly the opposite of what the church is intended to be living under is discord. We need to be in unity. And that's what I'm going to talk about first. Unity being the opposite of discord. In Ephesians chapter 4, beginning in verse 1, it says, I therefore, the prisoner of the Lord, beseech you that ye walk worthy of the vocation wherewith ye are called, with all lowliness and meekness, with long suffering, forbearing one another in love. And this is a quality that you need right away whenever you're going to have unity. There needs to be a lowliness and a meekness to each of the individual, where they esteem other better than themselves, and therefore they're able to show forth that long suffering. They're able to forbear one another. Why? Because love is the principal thing within the body, especially in the heart of somebody that has a low and meek feeling about themselves and a low and meek approach to their lives. Verse 3 says, endeavoring to keep the unity of the Spirit in the bond of peace. So again, this is something that we need to endeavor for. We need to strive after. It's a showing of our worthy walk that we have. We have an endeavoring, a desire to keep the unity of the Spirit. And again, another word that goes there is that bond of peace. Bonding is like when you put glue on something, put it together. That's the idea of unity. It's a oneness within that body. And here it explains it, verse 4. There is one body and one Spirit, even as ye are called in one hope of your calling. One Lord, one faith, one baptism, one God and Father of all, who is above all and through all and in you all. So essentially, when we walk worthy of the vocation wherewith we are called, we are simply just getting on board with God's program. He says very clearly here that there is one body. So when we have divisions, we're doing something that is not regular to the church or to the body of Christ. When we act as if there's a different spirit within our group, we are actually contrary to what God says. When he says there is one Spirit, there is one hope of our calling. Do we have different hopes? Do we have different callings and desires within that body? Then we're in error. There is one Lord. There is one faith. There is one baptism. There is one God and Father of all. The Bible says very clearly here. So if we are not acting in unity, we are not acting as we ought to be naturally as the body of Christ. It continues on in this chapter in verse 12. It says, for the perfecting of the saints, for the work of the ministry, for the edifying of the body of Christ, till we all come in the unity of the faith and of the knowledge of the Son of God unto a perfect man, unto the measure of the stature of the fullness of Christ. Again, highlighting the singleness here. The body is a singular term, the body of Christ. Right? Again, it says unity, that same term again that we are striving after, we are endeavoring towards. And again, it says a perfect man, a singular perfect man is what the body is supposed to react as and live as. The church is supposed to be when they are in accord one with another. Verse 16 says, from whom the whole body fitly joined together and compacted by that which every joint supplied, according to the effectual working in the measure of every part, maketh increase of the body unto the edifying of itself in love. A very interesting verse there. And then you see again, it's the whole body. The whole singular body joined together and compacted. In other words, the individuals are taken together and in that bond of peace, stuck together, compacted as if squeezed together, joined together so that they can be the body, so that they can be a perfect man, so that they can be the body of Christ in unity as one. And that's the opposite of the thing that God hates. He hates someone that soweth discord. He hates that someone would come in and try to promote and try to cause that there be discord among brethren. We are to be united. We are to be of one mind, of one aspect, of one desire, striving forth in the gospel, striving forth in the ministry wherewith we are called. And we do it all by way of verse 11, where it says, "And he gave some apostles, and some prophets, and some evangelists, and some pastors and teachers," just accentuating and highlighting the fact that there are individuals that have different ministries, different responsibilities, different purposes within that one body, but they're to all work together and strive to the end, that there would be a perfect thing of saints, that the work of the ministry would be complete and the whole body would be edified to the end, that the increase would be of itself in love. In other words, we all work together to grow to that one desire, that we would be a great representation of Christ upon earth as one body, moving forward in that same vein. If you were to turn there, Psalm 133, and I've preached on this before, it says, "Behold, how good and how pleasant it is for brethren to dwell together in unity." There, an Old Testament reference to the fact that it is good and it is pleasant for unity to be amongst brethren, amongst people that have the same Father, right, as we do in Christ. He describes it here as an anointing oil pouring down upon Aaron's beard. He describes it here as the dew of Hermon, replenishing the nature, the wildlife around, and giving what the ground needs. To the contrary, though, to all of these things and to all of what we're to be, we find that the hated thing and the finality of this teaching on six things is the yea seven that are abomination unto him. And I like how it's worded. We've called this teaching six things, but there is a yea seventh thing that is abomination unto the Lord. And you'll find that in Proverbs chapter 6, if you want to go back there, Proverbs chapter 6. We might as well read that passage as we're finishing it out. Proverbs chapter 6 and verse 16. Proverbs 6 verse 16 says, "These six things doth the Lord hate, yea, seven are an abomination unto him: a proud look, a lying tongue, and hands that shed innocent blood, and heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, feet that be swift in running to mischief, a false witness that speaketh lies, and he that soweth discord among brethren." And the reason why I like that yea seven is it almost is highlighting that there is something different about this seventh. What I see about the seventh is that all of the six previous tend to add to or tend to contribute to the seventh, he that soweth discord among brethren, coming to fruition, being in its fullness. And I'll show you what I mean here. Pride, the first one, the proud look. Pride lifts itself up and digs down others. Pride is something that is the opposite of love thy neighbor and love thy brethren, which is a tenet of the church, a preaching of the church, a right doctrine. It takes the love that's directed towards the neighbor, and because pride is so full of self, it just removes any love and directs it solely upon self. Pride is self-love, it's self-exaltation. And pride leads to the mentality that would sow discord among brethren. Why? Because you are different, you are better, you are above everyone else. That proud look can cause and sow discord among the brethren. The lying tongue then, it hurts, it harms, it manipulates. The Bible exhorts us to speak the truth in love one to another. While that lying tongue is actually not speaking the truth in love, it's speaking lies in hatred, in falsehood. It's exactly what it does when you speak lies. And hurt and harm and manipulation within a body is going to cause discord. It's going to cause the opposite of accord and unity. There will be disagreement, dispute, oppositions when there are lying tongues within a congregation. The heart that deviseth wicked imaginations, what this does is it builds falsehoods inwardly. It causes people to cloud their reality of their own mind as they see situations in one way and go home and begin to manipulate them in their own minds and dwell on things that happened. You know, so-and-so didn't shake my hand or they walked right by me. It might have just been an incident, an innocent overlook, but when you go home and you devise wicked imaginations and you build that untrust within yourself about a situation, then contempt is bred within somebody. Hatred is bred within somebody. And ultimately, murder is built within somebody. Well, what do you mean? Well, he that hateth his brother is a murderer, is he not? Of course. That hatred builds up to the point where, yes, you begin to be one that causes discord among brethren. Feet that be swift in running to mischief. Feet that be swift in running to mischief. That's someone that is diligent to break down, diligent to destroy, diligent to hurt and to harm, and they'll do it at a moment's notice. The last one, false witness that speaketh lies, is a slanderer, a railer. And each one of these identifications that God hates, each one of these things that God hates and finds an abomination, are ones that in the end they kill, they steal, and they destroy the unity. And they are traits just like their father, Satan himself, because he's here to kill, he's here to steal, and he's here to destroy. And there's a problem when that kind of mentality, there's a problem when that kind of action, there's a problem when this kind of thing is involved in the congregation of God. These things ought not be in the Christian's life. And yet we've seen as we've walked through this study that there are things that are very easy for Christians to fall into, very easy for Christians to succumb to, very easy for Christians to get involved in, and next thing you know, well, you're not hated of God as a child of the King. You are now doing things that are abomination unto him, and he hates those things. So in conclusion of this study, we see this one. Yea, seven that are abomination unto him, he that soweth discord among the brethren. Like I said, this is almost the end result of the six as they pile up on top of each other, is that there will be disunity whenever there is this kind of attitude, whenever there is this kind of thing within the congregation. The next time you find that idea of sowing discord, and actually the only other time you find it in the Bible, is in the same chapter. This chapter contains that phrase twice. Look back in chapter 6 of Proverbs and verse 12, and you're going to find the teaching here upon someone that soweth discord. And who does this type of thing? Well, look at verse 12. It says, a naughty person, a wicked man, walketh with a froward mouth. And I'll stop there. Look at that naughty and that wicked. A naughty person is a disobedient person. And even as we were studying the word mischief, I mentioned that that's kind of one of these words that's been softened. Really, it means a cruelty, an outright attack. It's a malicious, often a subversive attack. We talked about how Canada is making all these laws that are causing mischief, that they're sowing mischief by changing and framing laws so that somebody is guilty, you know, almost overnight. But the thing is, with naughtiness and mischief, these are words that have been, in our modern context, softened. Often they've been made to use almost like a silly kind of playful disobedience, right? We'll say little Johnny is naughty, or little Johnny is mischievous, right? But the reality is that naughtiness is disobedience, and disobedience is certain destruction. Christ asks us to obey the gospel. That's to believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. And if you disobey the call to call on him by faith and trust him for your salvation, you're headed for destruction. You are on your way to a devil's hell. 1 Timothy chapter 1 and verse 9 groups disobedience or naughtiness in with things like lawlessness, ungodliness, sinners, unholy, profane, murderers, whoremongers, them that defile themselves with mankind, those are whores, liars. These are all disobedient and grouped in with the disobedient. So we can't take a term like naughty and just say, oh, that's a softer term for something. Naughtiness is outright disobedience, and it falls in line with many other unrighteous sins. And in 1 Timothy, you find that the law was made for these very people, for the disobedient, for the lawless, for the ungodly. That's why the law was created, in order to allow them to conform and to have some sort of moral guideline. But we also know that the law, in the end, bringeth forth death. It's just a means by which somebody can see Christ. They can see their own fallen state and know Christ is the way out of it. So naughtiness, the naughty person is the one. The wicked man is the one. And here he walketh with a froward mouth, back in verse 12. Frowardness is something that is difficult, or someone that is difficult, and contrary. It's always causing controversy. And the froward mouth is the same. It's one that's always causing controversy, always stirring up strife, stirring up trouble. And that naughty person, that wicked man, is walking with that same mouth before them. Verse 13 says, he winketh with his eyes. He winketh with his eyes. And is someone trustworthy when they're winking with their eyes? I have an example. Obviously, the Lord is trustworthy, but it says of the sins of idolatry that he saw in the Old Testament. It said, for a time, in their ignorance, the Lord winked at them. In other words, he didn't approve, but he didn't act. He was in opposition to it, but he didn't act the same way when he was winking. And that's what somebody does when they're winking with their eyes. They don't agree. They don't approve. What they're saying, what they're doing is contrary, but the wink is signifying exactly that, that there is something different about their actions to how they actually feel. They're winking with their eyes is the naughty, the wicked man. They speaketh with their feet. They teacheth with their fingers. These are all things that are contrary. How do you speak with your feet? Teach somebody with your fingertips. These are contrary things. These are confusing things. And that's the same thing that groups in with the winking of the eyes that the naughty person does. And then it says this, frowardness is in his heart. So that same difficulty, that same controversy, that same uneasiness is within the heart of this person. It says, he deviseth mischief continually, he soweth discord. And this is what happens with the person that is naughty, the person that is wicked, the person that is froward, is that they are constantly causing and sowing discord because they are constantly contrary. In other words, everything that is said, everything that is spoken, they will react in the contrary. They will believe the contrary. And that is the person, that is the thing that the Lord hates. That is the one that soweth discord among the brethren. And he can carry all of these characteristics. You'll find the one that's sowing discord, again, to be proud, to be a liar, to have hands that shed innocent blood, to be quick to make imaginations, to be quick to run to mischief, to be a false witness that is speaking lies, and they're all, in the end, sowing discord among the brethren. They're contrary to the unity that is prescribed. Discord is the opposite of the one accord that the church is to be in. And that's why this is one of those things that the Lord hates, because it is contrary when someone is sowing discord to the very work of God, to the very pillar and ground of church that he set forth as his institution here upon earth. In Proverbs 6 and verse 15, it says, therefore shall his calamity come suddenly. Suddenly shall he be broken, and that without remedy. There presented the end of the one that soweth discord among brethren. Christians, I implore you, I encourage you, I plead with you, don't be this way. We've went over for the past 6 or 7 or 8 weeks as we found time to discuss the things that the Lord hates, to go over the things that the Lord hates. I highlighted ways that Christians behave just like the people that God hates, by being proud, by lying with their tongues, by manipulating, by all these things that God hates. Don't be this way. Don't be the one too that brings them all together and yea, soweth discord among brethren. Yea, he causes abomination. He causes stench to come to the nostrils of God when he soweth abomination. We're to be different, right? We're to be of one accord. We're to be humble, as we already saw in the first scripture. We're to be ones that lift up others, esteem others better than ourselves. We're to be ones that bring pleasantness and goodness to the heart of God, because we're dwelling together in unity as the anointing oil, as the dew of Hermon. We are to be people that dwell together in unity, and it starts with our own attitude. We need to be humble before others. We need to be lowly in our own mind. We need to esteem others better than ourselves. And you can read all about that in Ephesians chapter 4, as it highlights how the church is to behave of one mind. What was that mind? He said, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. That he was in the form of God, thought not robbery to be equal, right? He took himself upon himself the form of a man, the form of a servant, the form of a lowly, unesteemed servant of all, in order that he might be exalted in the end. And that is the low kind of mentality. That is the humble servitude that Christ exhibited that we need to follow after. Don't sow discord, sow to yourselves righteousness. It says in Hosea chapter 10 and verse 12, it says, sow to yourselves in righteousness, reap in mercy. In other words, as you're sowing, as you're planting, as you're giving forth righteousness, you are going to reap mercy in the same. That is the fruit of righteousness and sowing it. James chapter 3 and verse 18 says, the fruit of the righteous is sown in peace of them that make peace. So as you are sowing the peace that passeth all understanding. You are making peace and reaping peace, and that's the fruit that comes forth of sowing peace rather than sowing discord is what we're talking about. Matthew chapter 5 verse 9 said, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God."
Amen.
We're all the children of God, right? We are all sons of God. Blood bought, saved, child of the King, right? But when was the last time somebody called you such? That's something we have to examine, because the Bible says, "Blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God." Are you known as the children of God by others looking upon you? Are you one that is sowing in righteousness? Are you one that is sowing peace? Are you bringing forth fruit of the same mercy and righteousness and peace that passeth all understanding? Are you a peacemaker? If you're a peacemaker, the Bible promises you shall be called the children of God. You'll be recognized as somebody who is a child of the King and called of the same. The truth is, we are all that. The reality is, we don't behave that way too often, right? We're the ones that are sowing discord. We're the ones full of pride. We're the ones with lying tongues. We're the ones shedding innocent blood. We're the ones with heart devising wicked imaginations, feet running to mischief. We're the ones that are speaking false witness of our own brethren and sowing discord among the same. We ought to be different. We ought to be peaceful people, peacemaking people. And if you're saved, blood-bought child of the King, glory to God, act like it.
Amen.
Be called one today. Are you a peacemaker or are you sowing discord? Are you bringing the brethren together in unity and striving for the same, being lowly, being meek? Or are you full of pride and arrogancy, lifting self up, causing discord because you think you're better than somebody else? We need to sow that one accord. We need to bring about unity. We need to cause for peace to dwell within the midst of us, especially within the midst of us, especially with believers. I understand that the Bible even teaches that inasmuch as in you is, live peaceably with all men. That's talking about the world. That's saying that you're going to get in disputes. You're going to get into fights. You're going to have fights come to you. There's going to be all sorts of turmoil, tribulation, and struggle out in the world. But within the context of believers, within the assembly, within the body, we need to be of one accord. We need to have unity. We need to be at peace one with another and be one that strives for the same. If you find you have aught against anyone, leave there that gift before the altar and go and reconcile. If you have hurt somebody, hey, leave there that gift before the altar and go and apologize and make it right. We need to make sure that there is no grounds for those roots of bitterness to spring up within the congregation, because those roots of bitterness sprout up as envy, and envy causes turmoil and strife and contention, and I want none of that within this body. I want none of that within this congregation. The founders of the church had the same. If you go to Acts chapter 1, the founders of the church, Christ as the head, had the same. They had great unity when the church started off. In Acts chapter 1 and verse 14, the Bible says, "These all continued with one accord in prayer and supplication with the women and Mary, the mother of Jesus, and with his brethren." They continued with one accord, and their one accord was a dedication to prayer and to supplication. They came together for the purpose of finding petition before the throne of grace, calling upon the Lord to help, to heal, to strengthen, to encourage in those early days as they waited for the promise from the Father that the Holy Spirit would come. They continued. They waited. They worked together, strived together in the area of prayer, and they did it with one accord. They did it with unity. You'll find also in Acts chapter 2 and verse 1, it said, "And when the day of Pentecost was fully come, they were all with one accord in one place." You already found the apostles here with in one place, in one accord, ready, prepared for the work that is going forth. And that's how we need to be. We always need to be in one accord. Understand, we're always not in the same place. We're always not meeting in the same place. We may be here, we may be there. We're all across the countryside. Many of us commute out of dedication for the church congregation that we have here. But if we still have that spirit of one accord, God can still do great things, even when we're spread abroad, even when we're living in different places. In fact, one of the major downfalls of the early church was that they were dwelling amongst each other in such close proximity when God told them to go forth. I think we're actually at an advantage. We're a little bit spread out. Technology has definitely helped us. We can still contact one another and be in one accord and be united while we're still spread abroad and reaching different parts of this area in Southern Ontario as we minister and go about our days and do our daily business. God has the ability and we have the opportunity to do great things for him if we remain in one accord spiritually even when we are separated. If we remain with one desire and one motivation even when we are separated. But here we find them come together, meeting in one place, preparing for what? For God to send them forth to do a great work. He filled them with the Spirit and they went and preached the gospel. And this is what we do every Saturday. This is what we do every Sunday. This is what we do on special occasions. We get together with one accord in unity and prepare for God to do a great work through us. We saw that in the beginnings of the church. We need to have that today. Acts chapter 2 and verse 46 says, "And they, continuing daily with one accord in the temple and breaking bread from house to house, did eat their meat with gladness and singleness of heart." So we see then that singleness of heart, the gladness, the unity that comes from being one accord. And we see that they're in every house here. Yeah, they went to the temple and they met and they congregated in one place. Again, we do that Saturday. We do that Sunday. But then when they're back in their own house, they're of the same mind, the same spirit, the same dedication, the same devotion, praying for one another, reaching up to God and asking petitions one for another, lifting each other up before the throne of grace and asking that God would do a great work in so-and-so's life. God would do a great miracle in so-and-so's life. Being in one accord, being connected with that same spirit, even though they are spread abroad. The founders of the church had unity. Acts 4 and verse 24. Acts 4 and verse 24. We'll see it again. Acts 4 and verse 24. "And when they heard that, they lifted up their voice to God with one accord." When they heard that, they lifted up their voice with one accord to God and said, "Lord, thou art God, which has made heaven and earth and the sea and all them that is." So here, with one accord, they're lifting up and praising God. I challenge each and one of you to each and every day, lift up your voice with one accord as we, again, are spread abroad. But with unity, giving praise unto God, asking him petitions, lifting up him before all men that they might be saved because of hearing of the testimonies that you do have. In Acts chapter 5 and verse 12, you find this. "And by the hands of the apostles were many signs and wonders wrought among the people, and they were all with one accord in Solomon's porch." Again, we see this. The early church was always together, always in unity, always in unity of the mind, the spirit, and in person. They were together. They were motivated by the common cause to do great works for God and allow God to do great works for them. And we need to be the same. We need to be one. We need to be of one mind, of one spirit, of one desire, because the Lord knows that the enemy is. Acts chapter 7. Look at Acts chapter 7 and verse 56. Acts 7 and verse 56. And it says, "And said, Behold, I see the heavens open, and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God." Here's the conclusion of Stephen's great oration as he preached unto the Jews at this time. And he rounded it all out, this great discussion, this great explanation of the Old Testament and how things came about, with this statement in verse 51. He said, "You stiff-necked and uncircumcised in heart and ears, you do always resist the Holy Ghost as your fathers did, so do ye." And now as they come upon him and they start to gnash on him with his teeth, he's seeing that his end is near. He says, "Behold, I see heavens open and the Son of Man standing on the right hand of God," in verse 57. "Then they cried out with a loud voice," a singular loud voice, "and stopped their ears and ran upon him with one accord and cast him out of the city and stoned him. And the witnesses laid down their clothes at a young man's feet, whose name was Saul, and they stoned Stephen, calling upon God, saying, Lord Jesus, receive my spirit." Here the enemy of the gospel of Christ, here those that oppose the gospel of Christ and his teachings, are in one accord. They are prepared unto the work that is set before them. The time cometh when they that kill you will think that they do God's service, as these Jews did at this time, and yet they're in one accord. And why do we find so often it difficult for us to be in one accord? Acts chapter 19 and verse 29. Acts chapter 19 and verse 29. We'll go there. Acts 19 and verse 29. "And the whole city was filled with confusion." Remember, we talked about contrariness, right? We talked about the calamity that would come to those that are sowing discord, those that are of that froward, difficult, controversial mentality, that are always winking with their eyes, speaking with their feet, touching with their fingers, sowing discord among their brethren. There's great confusion within that group. And it says here, the whole city was filled with confusion. And having caught Gaius and Aristarchus, men of Macedonia, Paul's companions in travel, they rushed with one accord into the theater. Here, catching Christians and rushing them into the public eye, where they're planning to destroy them, where they're planning to kill them. And there is going to come a time, and though right now we see that, you know, the Jews and the Catholics and the Muslims and the homos and the vegetarians and all the people that oppose Christianity's ideologies, all the ones that oppose the teachings of the Bible, they're all scattered abroad. They're all different ways, going different directions, but you can see more and more they're all getting on the same page. Why? Because they found a common enemy. When you find a commonist, you find one accord. There's no longer discord among that group, because gradually, more and more each day, they're holding hands and singing Kumbaya, because their common enemy is the Lord. Their common enemy is the people of God. And that's just going to happen more and more and more each day, as the enemy becomes united and the enemy begins to be of one accord against the Lord and against his anointed. So much the more Christians today need to be of one accord. We need to be on the same page. We need to be in the same book. We need to be trusting the same Spirit. We need to be motivated by the same Father. We need to be seeking after the same Son. We need to be in the same direction. Some things we'll disagree with. Let's put those aside, with the common goal that we need to be in a state of togetherness, united, because why? The enemy is going to be united, and we all serve the same King. We all serve the risen Savior. So more and more and more, I believe Christians, Bible-believing Christians, need to come together, put our squabbles aside, put our differences aside, and recognize that, hey, if we're all in the same book, we all want to go and minister of the same Lord Jesus. We all want to trust in the same Spirit. One Lord, one faith, one baptism. When we get behind that, we're going to find power in that position. Why? Because that's the position that God wanted for us when he set forth the church, that we would be united, that we would be of one accord. Philippians chapter 2 and verse 2. Philippians 2 and verse 2. It says, "Fulfill ye my joy that ye be like-minded, having the same love, being of one accord, of one mind." And in verse 5 it says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." Like-mindedness, right? Unity, one accord, one mind. We need to be dedicated to the truth. We need to be focused on the Savior, the way, the truth, the life, Christ in us, the hope of glory. And if we do such, God can do great things. And we won't be one that sows discord. We won't be one that God hates. And we can be one that, in fact, serves him, loves him, is loved of the same, and is motivated, moves forward, presses on the upward way, new heights. I'm gaining every day. Still praying as I'm onward bound, Lord, plant my feet on higher ground. The only way we can do this is to be a Christian, be a believer that is a part of a body that is motivated to the same cause, to the same Savior, to the same purpose, fulfilling his desires, his wants, his needs within us. And we can do that here. We have great unity. We just need to sustain it. We need to strive for it. We need to be mindful of the ones that come in with those six things that the Lord doth hate. Do away with them. We don't need it. We don't need any of that. Help, fix, correct, right? Minister to, or eventually part ways with. Either way, Sound Words Baptist Church needs to be united. We need to have unity and not discord. And we need to each and every one of us as an individual have our hearts set on that same spirit of meekness. That same spirit that says, I'm esteeming you better than me. I'm not going to be proud. I'm not going to be arrogant. I'm down here and everybody else is up here. And when you do that, it gives you the perfect ground to grow as a Christian and to grow in this church. And I desire that more than anything at this time.